Hi, my name's Adam. Thanks so much for joining us today. Today we're in video 4 of our CPP series. So we talked about kind of when to take CPP and how to apply for it. We talked about the break-even point in the second video. In the third video yesterday, we talked about why you should take CPP at age 60. And today we're gonna cover off why you should take CPP at age 65. If you missed any of the previous videos, we'll put a link below to all of them. Make sure you watch them. They're great to watch in order. Again, how to apply and kind of what CPP is, when you should take it. The break-even point. Understand the break-even point of taking it at 60 versus 65. You know, what age do you have to live past? How much you'll be collecting? We break that all down for you. And then again, we want you to slot yourself into either, you know, yesterday's video, taking it at age 60, today's at 65, or tomorrow's at age 70. Hopefully you can find yourself in one of those videos. So watch all three plus the two previous ones, and it'll really guide you in helping you make the best decision around when to take your CPP benefit. So taking your CPP at age 65 is kind of the default answer. It makes the most sense. You know, Canadian pension plan, it is a retirement income stream, and most people, you know, the default retirement age is age 65. So they kind of go hand in hand. It makes sense. I get why that's kind of the default time to take it. But there's got to be more behind taking CPP at 65 versus just, well, I'm 65 and I'm retiring, so that's the default answer. You have to do more digging, more financial analysis to that, and more planning behind it than just defaulting to that. If you're defaulting to that, shame on you. So in this video, I'm going to go through 5 reasons and 5 considerations on why you should take CPP at age 65. And then I'll also go through a real life example of one of our clients that we recommended them to take it at 65 and why that is and the process behind that. So 5 reasons to take your CPP at age 65 would be: number 1 is you're retiring at 65 and you need income stream to replace your employment income. So kind of common sense, but if you're retiring at 65, which many of you do, you know, you have no employment income anymore. No one's giving you a check every, you know, 2 weeks or twice a month, whatever it is. You need to find a replacement for that income. So CPP is kind of a default. A lot of us will also apply for OAS at the same time. We won't go into that in this video. We'll do a future one on that. And then you may have RRSP or pension or whatever it is. So, you know, maybe you need some income stream to replace your employment income. That's kind of the first reason why you take it at 65. The second reason would be you had a pension plan. Maybe you've been retired for a bit and you had a bridge benefit as part of your pension plan. Okay, most of those bridge benefits cut off at age 65. So a lot of people will apply for CPP and or OAS to replace that bridge. So in theory, old age security is there to replace the bridge, but it doesn't always. Every pension's a bit different. We've seen bridges, you know, as low as $100, $150 or even lower. We've seen bridges up to $900 a month. So, you know, your old age security would not replace your bridge benefit of your pension plan. So sometimes applying for your CPP at the same time will help replace that larger bridge benefit. So just be aware of what your bridge benefit is if you have a pension plan, how much income that's bringing in, and if you need to replace the whole thing, your old age security may not be enough, so CPP may be required to help you replace that income. So reason number 3 is maybe you retired before age 65. Maybe it was 60, even 55, doesn't matter when, but you've done some tax planning leading up to this point. Maybe you retire, let's give an example, age 60. So you retired at age 60 and you had a bunch of RRSPs and you sat down with your financial planner and you determined that let's actually redeem RRSPs for the next 5 years. You know, get a lot of that money deregistered, take the income out of the RRSP, then delay CPP to 65. And now you've turned 65 and you're gonna turn on your CPP tap and you're gonna pull back on your RRSP withdrawal. So there's some tax strategy there. So if you've kind of built up a tax plan that's come to this point, you know, turning on your CPP tap at 65 may make the most sense depending on your plan. So again, we've done some plans with clients where we turn on that tap between 64 and 67 and work on redeeming RRSPs a bit earlier and just smooth out that overall tax bill. So reason number 4, and it's probably not a great reason right now because you can't travel anywhere, but a lot of people, and we do recommend, you know, you spend more money earlier in retirement. So I get, you know, take out the tax consequence of taking more money early, but, you know, turning on your CPP tap when you retire or when you're 65, it gives you income stream. And we can use that income stream more probably now than when we're 75 or 80 because we're healthy and we can travel. So, you know, if you wanna do more traveling, you have more expenses over the next maybe 10, 15 years than you would down the road, maybe it makes sense to turn on that CPP tap now, take a bit of that income now, and enjoy life, whether it's travel or whatever it is. So that's reason number four, to take CPP at 65. So reason number five, and it's similar to reason number three, but you've done some tax planning around when you should take income and how and from what sources and stuff, and it just happened to fall that CPP at 65 made the most sense. Again, it's kind of the default, and it's the default that a lot of financial planners will go to, whether that's right or wrong. But a lot of times they'll say, okay, CPP at 65, you retired at 60, how do we draw income from 60 to 65 and then beyond? So you've done some tax planning, and 65 is that number where, you know, tax-wise, marginal tax rate, keeping that low, everything else has come into your plan. At 65 is when we should turn on that tap. So that's the fifth reason why you should have have your CPP start at age 65. So let's jump into a quick real life example of one of our clients and some strategy that we use for them. And it's saved them tens of thousands of dollars between tax and extra income stream for down the road if they live to life expectancy of 86. So they retired at 60, just a hair before 60. They came to me and said, like, let's create a plan around income strategy. So we sat down, they had a bunch of RRSP money. Okay. So they had a bunch of RSP money. They have a small pension from their work. Both of them did. And then of course they can take CPP and OAS. So their question to me was, should we take CPP now, take RSP now? How should we kind of massage this along the way? So what we ended up doing is we took their RSP money and we actually created a five-year plan to really draw it down as quick as possible while keeping them in kind of the lower, the 22% tax bracket in BC. That's the client that we had in BC. So it allowed us to pay, you know, a smaller amount of tax. The average tax rate they paid was 12%. So again, not a whole lot of tax on redeeming those RSPs as fast as possible. So the strategy was, from 60 to 65, we were gonna redeem as much RSPs as we could in as low as a tax bracket as we could. And that would pay for their ongoing bills and that kind of stuff. And it also, you know, created some extra income stream that we put into their TFSA to create some flexibility there. Fast forward, when they turned 65, we turned on that CPP tap. We turned down substantially that RSP tap. So we were able to redeem a large part of their RSP in the first 5 years. And again, that just, you know, we didn't increase their income, we just took it from a different source. It allowed us to build up a tax-free savings account. And kind of a byproduct of that is that when you pass away with RSP money, if you have a spouse or common law partner, it can roll to them. But if you don't have a spouse or common law partner, whether you don't have one or they passed away already, if you have an RSP, it's taxed in the year that you pass away. So it's all income to you. So if you have a $500,000 RSP when you pass away and you don't have a spouse or common law partner, that's added to your income for that year. So one reason to kind of draw down RSP early, delay CPP, is just to remove that huge tax bill down the road, get that money deregistered, you know, save it into a tax-free savings, or use it for your everyday expenses that you have. So kind of a byproduct of the plan, but that's one scenario that we recommended a client to take their CPP at age 65 versus 60. If the client had more RSP money, we would have probably bumped CPP even later. But we'll go into a video on that tomorrow on why to take CPP at 70, and we'll break down a different example that we used on why we recommended age 70 for CPP. So thanks for joining us in this video today. Again, talking about why you should take your CPP at age 65. So if one of those five reasons or even our example kind of hit home with you, maybe you fall into this bucket. Maybe you don't. But if you feel like you do, maybe 65 is a good age, maybe a bit before, a bit after, on when to take your CPP. But hopefully this video helped you give some clarity on why you should maybe look at 65 to turn on that CPP tap. So thanks again for joining us in video 4 of 5. We got one more coming tomorrow on taking your CPP at age 70. Again, if you haven't subscribed to the channel yet and you're watching these videos, please subscribe, like the video. It does help get this content out to more people. More Canadians need to learn more about when to take CPP, how it works, and strategies around when they should be taking it based on their unique situation. We come across people all the time that have turned on their CPP tap that should not have. They're losing half of it to the government. So we need to get these videos out to more people. Hit the thumbs up. It really does help get those videos out. So thanks so much for joining us today. Have a great day.